The baseball career of John Garrett Olerud begins with his dad, retired physician John Everett Olerud. The elder Olerud played for the Washington State Cougars from 1961 to 1965 under legendary coach Chuck Bobo Brayton. He was a two-time team MVP and was named All-American in 1965. As an All-American, Olerud hit .341, leading the Cougars to a third-place finish in the College Baseball World Series. Coach Brayton said of the elder Olerud, "His heart is what made him so good. No one ran on him." Olerud would be inducted into the WSU Hall of Fame in 1986. Following his university baseball career, Olerud was drafted by the California Angels in the fourth round of the 1965 amateur draft. He made his professional debut in AAA, playing for his hometown Seattle Angels. While playing a doubleheader on August 5, 1968 in Tacoma, Washington, John's wife, Linda Olerud, went into labor in a hospital in Seattle and gave birth to their son, John Garrett Olerud. Olerud Sr. would retire from baseball in June 1971 to pursue his career in medicine, after receiving his doctorate degree from the University of Washington School of Medicine. From 1965 to 1971, Olerud played for five minor league teams, reached AAA, amassed 1,821 career minor league plate appearances, and hit .265 with 12 career home runs. John Everett Olerud was a very good ball player. Though he never made it to the majors, he ultimately did something even more important. He exposed his son to the game and built the foundation for which the younger Olerud could reach even greater heights. "I'd go into spring training, and he was a little kid who really loved balls and to hit," Olerud Sr. said. "I remember once in spring training, I was in the Montreal Expos organization, and we were in West Palm Beach. He'd be down there with his little plastic bat. I'd be throwing balls, and he'd be ripping the balls into the surf. People would stop and say, 'Wow, that little kid is good.'" John Olerud wasn't just good at baseball. He was gifted. The skinny left-hander played baseball and golf at Interlake High School in Bellevue, Washington, east of Seattle. He lettered all three seasons in both sports. As a junior, he hit .435 and was 9-2 with a 1.54 ERA on the mound. As a senior, he was named to the All-County and All-State teams, winning the MVP award in the All-State game. His play at Interlake High School led to John being drafted by the New York Mets in the 27th round of the 1986 amateur draft. With this amazing opportunity in front of him, he had elected instead to go to university. "Those were tough decisions, and to be honest, I wasn't really forward-thinking to where I was going. I went down and visited Stanford, and they just wanted me to pitch. I loved hitting, and both the University of Washington and Washington State would allow me to do both. It came down to the two Washington schools. I think my dad's experience at Washington State, he felt like the best coach he had ever played for was Bobo Brayton, as far as an instructor and just coaching and knowing the game. At that time, too, Washington State was clearly the best baseball school. They both told me I would be able to pitch and hit." John Olerud followed in his dad's footsteps and chose Washington State University to play for Coach Brayton. Brayton said, "The raw potential of Olerud was obvious even when he turned out as a skinny freshman. I wouldn't even run him with the other pitchers because he was so slow. He couldn't do a pull-up or a push-up. I used to run him and adjust my speed so he didn't look so bad." His skinny build disguised his incredible strength on the field. In 1987, the freshman year for the Cougars, Olerud would hit .414 with 5 home runs and 20 RBIs. But he was just as impressive on the mound, going 8-2 with a 3 ERA. This performance earned him All-American honors. Olerud remained in Pullman following his freshman season playing for the Palouse Empire Cougars of the Alaska Summer League. He got a chance to play more first base than he had as a freshman. He also earned himself a shot with Team USA, getting a chance to travel to Cuba for the Intercontinental Cup, playing alongside future MLBers Chuck Knobloch, Robin Ventura, and John Valentin. He was used strictly as a pitcher, and he struggled some, finishing 2-0 with a 3.94 ERA in 15 innings. "I didn't feel that bad in Cuba," he says. "My arm felt good and I was throwing the ball well. I just wasn't throwing strikes." That may have cost him a chance to play in the Olympics that summer. Olerud was not issued an invitation to try out for the U.S. team. "It's too bad it wasn't another year or so," said Brayton. "In another year, he'll really be something." Coach Brayton was right. He really would be something. But he didn't have to wait a year to see just how special John Olerud could be. Olerud's 1988 sophomore season was possibly the greatest single season in collegiate history. The 6'5 left-hander hit a record-shattering 464 with 23 home runs and 81 RBIs, good enough for the league's Triple Crown. On the mound, he was just as impressive, going 15-0 with a 2.49 ERA and 113 strikeouts. He led collegiate baseball in two-thirds of those pitching categories, missing the Triple Crown in pitching also. His remarkable season earned him Baseball America's College Player of the Year Award and consensus All-American as a hitter and pitcher. Olerud was the first collegian ever to win double-digit games on the mound and hit 20 home runs in the same season. He was so good at pitching and hitting, the John Olerud Two-Way Player of the Year Award was named after him. When Gonzaga coach Steve Hertz was asked, "How good is he?" he said, "I think he might be the best player in the country. We've played both teams that have been ranked number one in the country, Fresno State 3 times and Oklahoma State 2 times, and he's by far the best player we've seen." "It was definitely my year this year," said Olerud. "The hits were falling. I'd get the breaks on the mound." But not all the breaks would go John's way. In December 1988, while prepping for the upcoming season, Olerud suffered an intense headache while working out. It happened again another week later. He didn't think they were too worrisome and didn't tell anyone about them. But things got worse on January 11th, 1989, when he collapsed while jogging with a teammate at the Hollingbury Fieldhouse track. He didn't wake up until an hour later. Diagnosed with a subarachnoid hemorrhage, bleeding in the spinal column, he stayed in the hospital for 2 weeks before returning to school in February, planning to resume baseball in March. His recovery process hit a snag on February 24th when he went to see Dr. Richard Wynn, the head of neurosurgery at the University of Washington. Dr. Wynn took several x-rays of Olerud's brain and found something potentially deadly, an aneurysm near the brain. "It was a frightening thing," said his dad. "But we were fortunate the aneurysm was found within a few weeks." John underwent 6 hours of extremely high-risk surgery. The operation was a success, but he still faced a multitude of challenges. Surgeons had to cut open his head to get to the aneurysm, which left an unprotected portion when they were finished. As a result, he began to wear a helmet on the baseball field at all times, a practice he continued his whole career. "I feel lucky to have made it through all that. Once I made it through surgery, I could see clearly and move everything all right. I figured playing again was just a matter of getting my strength back." Olerud made his season debut on April 15th, 1989, less than 2 months after going under the knife. He batted .359 with 5 home runs, 30 RBIs, and 78 at-bats, and went 3-2 with a 6.68 ERA on the mound. "I definitely feel a little more mortal because of what happened," Olerud said. "Being young and in good shape, I obviously had no idea anything like this could happen to me. I feel fortunate it turned out the way it did." Even after a solid post-surgery season, he decided to skip the 1989 MLB draft, where he was ranked number 3 overall by Baseball America, and he decided instead to return to Washington State for his senior year. He even went so far as to explicitly tell teams not to select him. The Toronto Blue Jays, however, didn't listen and took him in the 3rd round. Toronto made him an offer of $400,000, which would have been the highest bonus in baseball history. Olerud turned it down, but later that month signed a 3-year deal for $800,000 that included a $250,000 bonus. It also guaranteed that he would start his career in the majors. "They made me an offer that was too good to pass up," Olerud said. "I had an opportunity to be in a pennant race, and that's something a lot of great players never experience. I didn't think they could offer me enough to drive me away from Washington State, but what they came up with were things I couldn't have had after my senior year." Olerud finished his three-year college career hitting .434 with 33 home runs, 131 RBIs in 131 games. On the mound, he went 26-4 with a .317 ERA in 241 and a third innings. In 2001, John Garrett Olerud would join his father, John Everett Olerud, in the WSU Hall of Fame. The family circle was complete. Now it was time for the apprentice to become the master. John Olerud made his major league debut for the Toronto Blue Jays on September 3, 1989, pinch hitting for Fred McGriff. He singled in his lone plate appearance. In doing so, he became just one of 22 players to skip the minors and make their debut in the majors. A remarkable achievement on so many levels, but especially considering he had a brain aneurysm just 8 months earlier. Olerud finished his first stint in Major League Baseball going 3-for-8 with 2 runs scored in 6 games played. With his Major League career now underway, 1990 would mark his official rookie season. The sweet swinging left-hander held his own at the plate, hitting .265 with 14 home runs, 48 RBIs, and 358 platoon at-bats. Good enough for a 4th-place finish in Rookie of the Year voting. Over the next 2 seasons, Olerud would continue in a platoon role for manager Cito Gaston. 1992 marked his best offensive season to date, hitting .284 with 16 home runs and an .825 OPS in 458 at-bats. He also won his first World Series title that season, batting .333 during the Jays' playoff run. His production was steady, but overshadowed in a position dominated by big slugging first basemen like Mark McGwire and Cecil Fielder. Being overshadowed would come to define Olerud's major league career, which is exactly how he preferred it.
I'd like to just blend in, come to the ballpark and play. I think there's so many other things that go on here in the city that, unless you really are having unbelievable numbers or an unbelievable year, you're pretty much going to blend in. So I'm looking to have a good year, but I'm perfectly content just blending in with everybody.
The 1993 season would yank Olerud from the shadows and throw him directly into the major league spotlight. Coming off a World Series title and his best offensive season in the majors, Olerud would set new career goals for himself.
Last year was my best year, hitting .284, and I think coming into the year, I felt like hitting .300 was a reasonable goal to shoot for. 20 or more home runs and 80 or more RBIs.
300 average, 20 plus home runs, 80 plus RBIs. That was the goal. And in order to reach those goals, Cito Gaston insisted he must become more aggressive at the plate and pull the ball. In spring training, he's hitting line drives all over the place against the Phillies, and guys are right there catching them. John came up to me and said, "Cito, I'm making a lot of guys look good today." And I said back to him, "Just keep swinging, John." Then in the regular season in Kansas City, the same thing is happening. He's a left-handed hitter, and guys are playing him right on the left field line, catching line drives he'd hit there. So John comes up to me and says the same thing, "Cito, I'm making a lot of guys look good today." This time I said, "John, pull the ball a bit more."
You know, that's something that they've always tried to get me to do, is be more aggressive early in the count, because in years past, I would really get behind in the count and have to hit some tough pitches.
And hit tough pitches he did. Month after month after month after month, John Olerud hit major league pitchers to a tune of .402 through the end of July. I came out of nowhere. I don't think anyone was expecting 400 out of me. John Olerud would hit 400 into August 2nd, the deepest into a season anyone has hit 400 since Ted Williams hit 406 in 1941. It should be noted, George Brett was hitting .3995 as late as September 21st, but because we got a roundup, and this is my documentary, it don't count. Moving on. John Olerud's 1993 season was one for the Blue Jays record book. He would go on to lead the league in batting average, on-base percentage, OPS, OPS+, doubles, and intentional walks. He also put together a 26-game hit streak, won two Player of the Month awards, and added 24 home runs, 107 RBIs, and 109 runs scored. Good enough for a third-place finish in MVP voting behind winner Frank Thomas and teammate Paul Molitor. The spotlight was now directly on the unassuming left-hander and his sweet, compact swing. A swing so perfect, even Don Mattingly studied it to pull himself out of a batting slump in 1990.
The only thing more mesmerizing than Olerud's chase of 400 was the swing that was launching 1,000 adjectives.
Very controlled swing. Look at that. Head doesn't hardly move. Short stride, and boy, those hands come through quick.
He continues. Come up with hit after hit after hit.
Stays right on it, gets great extension.
Good example of how your head stays engaged. It stays close to the plate, allows you to get through the ball.
Stays on the ball, chokes up on the bat a little bit.
Well, this is just the textbook swing. If you wanted to take pictures and put it in a book, that's the swing to do it with right there.
The camera, picture perfect, it's Kodak moment every time he swings. Everything the same, you never see him get fooled.
Never.
Oh, this is serious here against California. When he just, everything he hit went out. What, he hit four home runs that series?
Here comes the natural, and he blasts the first pitch. Olerud hit it a ton. It's gone. Home run. Unbelievable.
Watch his follow through. Head is always down. That is a big key. You never see him come up like this where his head comes out. His head is always down through the hitting zone, and he just follows the ball just like a golf swing. Boom. Follow the ball. You can't teach that.
Olerud's breakout season of 1993 concluded with a second World Series championship. He contributed to the cause by hitting 311 playoff games, scoring 10 runs, walking 10 times, and driving in 5. But a closer look behind the playoff curtain indicated a level of mistrust the Blue Jays coaching staff had for the reigning batting champion. In Game 3 of the World Series in Philadelphia, Cito Gaston sat John Olerud in favor of Paul Molitor with no DH against left-hander Danny Jackson. Gaston stuck with Ed Sprague at third and put Molitor at first. Molitor himself assumed he would play third, a position he had held most of his career. "I thought I'd play third base in the National League City. Cito's position on players is to make them as comfortable as possible. It has been a long time since playing third base, but I wanted to do it." Gaston had indicated for several days he was not comfortable with Molitor playing third. Molitor had surgery on his right shoulder after the 1990 season, and he has not played third base since. Molitor has not been a third baseman since 1990. It's not fair for him to play a position he hasn't played for a long time. "I see no particular risk with me at third," Molitor said. "My skills may have diminished, but the risks are minimal." The move paid off for Gaston and the Blue Jays. Molitor drove in 3 runs and scored 3, leading his club to a 10-3 victory. But an unspoken statement had been made, and the pressure to turn John Olerud into something he wasn't would only increase. "Ollie is so patient that he used to get himself behind in the count," says Gene Tennis. "He'd take on a couple of strikes because they weren't his kind of strikes, and before you knew it, he'd be behind 0-2 or 1-2. We tried to keep reminding him to be aggressive early in the count." The following spring, it was again suggested that Olerud concentrate on hitting for more power by pulling the ball. As a result, his stroke would deteriorate. He hit .297 in the strike-shortened season of 1994, .291 in 1995, and down to .274 in 1996, the final season of John Olerud's Blue Jays career. Gaston's patience with him worn thin. With Carlos Delgado nipping at his heels and a highly paid Joe Carter at DH, Blue Jays GM Gord Ash traded John Olerud to the New York Mets on December 20th, 1996 for 27-year-old right-hander Robert Person. The Blue Jays also sent $5 million of John Olerud's $6.5 million contract to unload him. I don't blame Toronto for trading me because I had a big contract and I was coming off some mediocre years, says Olerud. It was clear that I needed a fresh start. I could have swung the bat the way I thought was best, but I didn't. I did what they asked because I wanted them to stick with me. I learned a lesson that you have to stay with whatever style makes you successful. Blue Jays GM Gord Ash wishes he could have him back. They weren't on the same page, Ash said in reference to Olerud and Toronto's coaching staff, which at the time included hitting coach Willie Upshaw. The trade would turn out to be one of the worst in Blue Jays history. Robert Person would pitch parts of three seasons for the Jays, going 8-13 with a 6.18 ERA and 177 and two-thirds innings pitched. Meanwhile, Olerud, who left the Blue Jays after seven seasons, posting a career .293 average, .395 on-base percentage, and .866 OPS, would go on to resurrect his career with the New York Mets.
Meet the Mets! Meet the Mets! Step right up and greet the Mets!
The New York Mets were a team on the rise in 1996. Their 71-91 record disguised the fact that there was much to be hopeful about. Edgardo Alfonso and Jeff Kent were rising talents. Todd Hundley and Bernard Gilkey put up elite numbers. And Lance Johnson was coming off a great season. But there was a hole in the lineup at first base where Butch Husky stood. The Mets saw an opportunity to buy low on an elite player. Olerud arrived in Queens as a player in search of himself. He wanted to get back to doing what came naturally, hitting the ball to all fields. New to the team that season was Mets hitting coach Tom Robson. Robson coached with Bobby Valentine in Texas and Japan. Robson's philosophy on hitting was a perfect match for Olerud. He simply let him be himself. My approach is to make the player understand how the body works. If they understand how the body works, they can create their best bat speed. My main thing is I don't change much of anything. I use what the player has with a goal to have the player get better. You have to make decisions in a split second. It's why Griffey and Bonds are so good. They see a ball quicker than the average guy, and they see it coming slower. It's recognition. Recognition and executing a swing in 0.2 seconds. You make a decision and you execute. This approach helped Olerud have a bounce-back season in 1997. He hit .294 with a .400 on-base percentage, 22 home runs, and 102 RBIs, good for a .138 WRC+. And paired with his defense, he was worth 4.4 wins above replacement. The Mets would win 88 games that season, a 17-game improvement from the year before. After a strong first season with the Mets, management re-signed Olerud to a two-year, $8 million contract. He rewarded his club with the best season of his career, hitting .354 with 23 home runs, 93 RBIs, and posting an 8.1 wins above replacement, third best behind only Barry Bonds and Mark McGwire. His .354 average set a franchise record. The Mets finished the 1998 season in the same position as 1997, winning 88 games and just missing the playoffs. But they were no longer considered underdogs. This Mets squad, with one of the best infield defenses in the history of baseball, was considered a threat to win it all going into the 1999 season. As exciting as the 1998 season was for John, something even more special happened at home. His wife, Kelly Olerud, married since 1992, and a former Interlake High classmate who attended Arizona State on a volleyball scholarship, gave birth to their first child, Garrett John Olerud. Olerud's batting average would fall 56 points in 1999, but he still remained one of the best first basemen in the game. He would go on to finish the season hitting .298 with 19 home runs, 96 RBIs, and scoring 107 runs. He set another franchise record, walking 125 times. The Mets finally broke through and made the postseason in 1999, reaching the NLCS before bowing out against the Atlanta Braves in six games. Olerud was not to blame for the failure to win the pennant, though. He hit .438, .525, .625 in the NLDS, and .296, .345, .519 in the NLCS. He even tagged three home runs in 10 playoff games, after hitting just 19 all season. Olerud credits Robson for saving his career. He was the perfect hitting coach. He was the best hitting instructor I've ever had, no question about it. He was the best. Tom Robson would write a book in 2003 about hitting titled The Hitting Edge. The foreword was written by John Olerud. Unfortunately for the Mets, all good things must come to an end. Olerud's tenure with the team concluded after the 1999 campaign. The Mets fought with the Seattle Mariners for his services. According to John, the two teams made similar offers, but the allure of playing at home was too strong to turn down. Olerud would leave the Mets holding several franchise records. He joined the team as a player in decline, but he would leave them as one of the best players in baseball. John would ink a three-year, $20 million deal with the Mariners. The Mets offered very similar numbers, but ultimately playing at home won out. One of the reasons we came to Seattle was that we wanted another baby, and we wanted both sets of grandparents to be around Garrett. This was a real difficult decision for me. There were times where I was leaning toward the Mets, definitely. I came close, but never to the point where I said, let's go for it. John was having a successful first season with the Mariners, but as the dog days of August got underway, Kelly would give birth to the couple's second child, Jordan Marie Olerud. The birth of Jordan would alter their lives forever. Jordan was not your typical child. She was born with a chromosomal abnormality called trisomy 2P5P negative, which means Jordan had an extra second chromosome and was missing part of her fifth. She would require constant care from John and Kelly. Their decision to be close to family and friends proved necessary. It was a challenge that is hard to explain to anyone who hasn't been there, Olerud explains. There were times in the final month of the season where Jordan's medical situation was up in the air. Olerud noticed an impact on his play. It definitely makes it difficult to play baseball. What happened with Jordan was a lot of work. The last month of the 2000 season was the hardest. The team was in a pennant race and Kelly had her hands full when I wasn't around. Olerud finished his first season in Seattle hitting .285 with 14 home runs, 103 RBIs, walking 102 times and posting an .831 OPS. A successful season by anyone's standards. He also won his first gold glove, finally winning the recognition he deserved for being a great defensive first baseman. The Mariners would go on to win the 2000 ALDS, but lost in the ALCS to the Yankees. Olerud did everything he could, hitting .333 with an OPS over 1,000. The following season was one of the best ever in MLB history for the Mariners. The club tied a major league record with 116 victories, equaling the 1906 Chicago Cubs. Olerud again played a key role in the team's success. He hit .300 for the third time in his career, contributing 21 home runs, 95 RBIs, and an .873 OPS, good enough to earn him his second All-Star team selection. A record 8 Mariner players would be voted to the All-Star team that season. The Mariners concluded their record year in the ALCS, losing again to the Yankees. 2002 was more typical Olerud. He hit .300, drove in 102, walked 98 times, and posted an .893 OPS. He added more hardware by winning his second gold glove. The Mariners would win 93 games that season, but would miss the playoffs. Olerud lived up to every expectation of his three-year deal. Concluding the 2002 season, the 34-year-old re-upped with Seattle, signing a two-year, $15.4 million deal. With Garrett ready to start school and his extended family living in the Seattle area, Olerud said he did not consider any other team. But the 2003 season was the beginning of the offensive decline for John Olerud. He finished that year with 10 home runs, a .269 batting average, and a career-worst OPS of .761. On the upside, he would go on to win his third Gold Glove with the Mariners, so even with the offensive decline, John still found a way to positively contribute to the team. Most importantly that year, John and Kelly started the Jordan Fund. The fund's mission was to provide support to special needs children and their families. The 2004 season marked an end of John's time in Seattle. He was released after 78 games before being picked up by the Yankees, who were looking for first base depth while Jason Giambi dealt with complications from steroids. Olerud would play in the ALDS and ALCS for the Yankees. He hit .192 in 26 at-bats. As the career of John Olerud was winding down, his family continued to grow. Kelly would give birth to their third child, Jessica. 2005 marked the final season of John Olerud's baseball career. The 36-year-old veteran was recovering from surgery to repair torn ligaments in his left foot suffered during the Yanks playoffs the previous season. He signed a minor league deal with the Red Sox and appeared in 3 minor league games during a rehab stint. It was the only minor league games he played during his 17-year career. In 87 games with the Sox, Olerud hit .289 with 7 home runs, 37 RBIs, and posted a .795 OPS. In his final playoff appearance, he went 2-for-7 with 2 walks. The Red Sox lost in 3 games to the White Sox. John Olerud finished his career as one of the most underrated first basemen to ever play the game. He appeared in 2,234 games, hit 255 home runs, drove in 1,230 runs, smacked 500 doubles, and batted .295. He played for 2 championship teams, won 3 Gold Gloves, and appeared in 2 All-Star games. John wasn't loud, he wasn't flashy, he didn't want the spotlight. He just loved playing the game of baseball. And he loved his family. In 2020, Jordan Marie Olerud would pass away at the age of 19. The Olruds, who are devout Christians, said their faith had calmed the rough seas. "I think what helps me as much as anything is our faith," Olerud said. "It helps in the tough times, knowing that God is in control and has a plan. That definitely helps." Despite the obstacles placed in Jordan's way, she lived a life that inspired her family and others. She co-wrote a book with her friend and nurse, Rochelle Sheets, titled Mystery at the Horse Show. She dedicated it to her sister and wrote, "This book is dedicated to my beautiful sister, Jessica. I love that you are so joyful and full of energy and enthusiasm. Our time together is always a grand adventure. I'm blessed to have such a wonderful sister." A second book was planned before Jordan passed away. If you would like to donate to the Jordan Fund to help families in need, please head to jordanfund.org. Thank you for watching this documentary. John Olerud was one of my favorite players. I loved the way he played, I loved the way he carried himself, and it was an honor to learn more about him and his family.
Gives the Blue Jays their first lead of the night. It's 5-4 Toronto.